This forum is not only about collecting business cards and building network, but also a great opportunity to learn from and about our fellow liberals. So if you are new attending the session or the Asia Liberty Forum, I mean, I request you all to please, you know, exchange business cards, make sense, friend for life, rather. If you haven't, as of now, downloaded the free app, Hello Crowd, then I would request you to please do, because, you know, yesterday we had so many pictures coming up. I don't know if you noticed, we were also projecting on the screen. And as I'm saying, for 2 days, be narcissist. Like, take as many selfies as possible and put it up on Twitter and the Hello Crowd app. It's a free app, as I said. It's one word, so if you want to download, you can. If you are unable to, I will help you out as well. If you missed to register yesterday, then I would request again to please register yourself. That will help us as well. Great. With these, today's session are mostly going to be concurrent sessions. So all the three rooms, so you know, you're free to roam around any place you wish to. The first up is What's Winning Political Strategy, chaired by Praveen Chakraverty. Praveen Chakraverty is a visiting senior fellow in political economy at IDFC Institute. He has spent 2 decades in the corporate world, largely in financial across India and the US. Retiring as CEO of an Indian investment bank in 2013, Praveen is the founding trustee of India Spend, India's first non-for-profit data journalism initiative that heralded the data journalism culture in mainstream media. So we'd like to call upon Praveen. The panel constitutes of Rajesh Jain from Free a Billion India, Matt Kibbe from Free the People, USA, Won Saiful Wonyan, Institute for Democracy and Economic Affairs, Malaysia.
Good morning. What's a winning political strategy is the title for our session this morning. I'm going to start with a quote by Jean-Claude Juncker, the president of the European Commission and the former prime minister of Luxembourg. He said, as politicians, we all know what to do. We just don't know how to get reelected after we've done that. It's perhaps he was speaking in the context of liberal ideas, because this statement couldn't be any more true than in the context of liberal ideas. And what I thought we'd do is, we agreed that we're not going to do formal presentations. We're going to make it interactive. We'll just have a very candid, freewheeling discussion and open it up for as many questions as we can. So I'll start by somewhat kind of laying out the context in India, the Indian context for today's session. And then we'll go around and talk about experiences from across the world. See, the question, what's a winning political strategy? There's an inherent presumption in this question, which is political parties can be liberal, but voters or majority of voters are not. And hence, how do you convince them to be a winner? I just had somewhat of a contrasting experience in the last few days. I returned from a city called Chennai in the south of India just last night. What is happening in that state, and it's a state called Tamil Nadu, which is one of India's richest states. It is India's richest state on a per capita GDP basis. So clearly developed and all of that, but in the Indian context. What's happening there right now is 130 out of the 234 elected legislators are holed up, locked up in a hotel. They're locked up in a hotel room, clearly against their wishes, because nobody likes to be locked up. And when I say locked up, their mobile phones taken away, they're not allowed to exit the hotel, yeah? And the angst among people there are like, why are these people locked up inside? It's almost a reversal of the voters claiming freedom, and the elected legislators seem perfectly happy being locked up. And the background of the situation is they have to vote in a particular manner on a contentious issue in an assembly, expressing their support, to make sure that they do not defect, they are actually locked up. India's richest state. So it's not entirely true that leading political parties can be liberal religious voters or not. It could be exactly the opposite. It's the same state that witnessed some protests about a month ago, entirely voluntary. And the protests were inherently about freedom. They were inherently about freedom because they were indulged in a sport, which is, you know, somewhat like a bull taming sport. And there was a Supreme Court judgment that said you can't do it, but that was just the pretext. There were thousands and thousands of people that came out, protested against this, but their inherent protest was, why are you intruding into my freedom? So it's almost like maybe we're looking at this the wrong way, because maybe there is a marketplace already for liberal ideas, for freedoms. And it's the political parties, perhaps, in the Indian context, that are not responding to it as they should. Could be one way of looking at this. So I wanted to set that context in saying it's not necessarily true always that it's the challenging part is to convince voters to vote for liberal ideas and liberal parties. It could be the other way. And this could be termed as a failure of the electoral marketplace, because there clearly is a customer base for a certain set of ideas. No political entrepreneur has come in to actually cater to that customer base. And there could be various barriers, and there could be failure of this electoral marketplace. So we could talk about that as well a bit. So with that, you know, kind of both sides of the issue, I want to start really with you, Matt, and ask you, clearly we've gone through an extraordinary campaign in the United States that has resulted in a candidate, you know, who's fairly contentious, but you've been very closely involved in the campaign, and I wanted to first start by asking you, where did you all go wrong?
Well, I think the context for what's going on in the United States is really a global story about a political paradigm shift away from top-down structures and the way that politicians hoard information and the way that we're always been taught to find the right guy, elect the right guy to office that believes in the right ideas and everything else follows. And I think what we're discovering is that model never made sense in the first place. Politicians respond to incentives, and unless there is a constituency for classical liberal ideas, unless there's an organized machine that will help elect and help protect politicians who do the right thing, you're going to find yourself again and again frustrated. And Donald Trump, ironically, is the product of this radical democratization in politics. And I guess it started with the Tea Party. I could go back further, but the first time that I noticed that an organized grassroots movement could have political consequences was in the congressional elections of 2010. Every single expert, every pollster, every Republican strategist predicted that Republicans couldn't take the House, and yet this social movement, this Tea Party movement, managed to do that and broke all the rules. In the process, electing a lot of classical liberal politicians like Rand Paul and Justin Amash, Mike Lee, and a host of others, many of whom ran for president in 2016. Marco Rubio, Scott Walker, of course, Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, who was elected in the next election based on Tea Party organization. So you had this crowded Republican field of a new breed of politician, And I work for Rand Paul, so I'm biased. I think Rand was head and shoulders better than the rest. Rand Paul is someone that's read Human Action. He's read Adam Smith. He can quote Hayek with the best of them. And at one point, not too long ago, he was considered the front runner. Time magazine had him the most interesting politician in America. And then along comes Donald Trump, the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man of American politics, breaking things, knocking things down, and really sort of breaking the model. And he did it through Twitter. He was the Twitter queen of American politics. And to me, it's a little strange because he was a pop celebrity, wasn't a politician.
Right.
But he leveraged social media in a way that had never been done before. He didn't raise that much money through the traditional political system. And in a sense, he broke politics as we know it. But I view that as an opportunity. The fact that Rand Paul and Ted Cruz and other politicians were on that presidential stage, that would have been unimaginable 2 years before. And yet we got to that point. And I, of course, defected and went to the Libertarian Party and worked for Gary Johnson.
I actually want to kind of push you a bit there. First, you started off saying there is no constituency. And then you also said that Donald Trump and Twitter literally broke it.
Yeah.
The Twitter part is tactical. So which of this is true? Is there a constituency and you failed on the tactics? Or there was no constituency?
Both are true. And it's that the left in the United States has a phrase which I stole from them: build to win and win by building. And the Tea Party started off as a protest movement. We were marching in the streets. We were building a constituency for limited government and constitutional freedom. Then we became a de facto political party. It was never intended to be a political party, but we had a constituency, so we started electing candidates. And that machinery, that constituency for liberty is still there. It just is not to the point where it can win a national election. So all politics happens at the margin, and I think we need to understand that we're never going to have as much money as the bad guys. We're never going to have the rules in our favor, but what we have is the power of community, the power of the democratization of ideas, the ability to reach millions and millions of people who we would just a few years ago call rationally ignorant when it comes to politics. Too busy, too uninterested in politics to pay attention. Now through social media, through Twitter, through Facebook, we can actually reach those people. Mm. This is the biggest opportunity that classical liberals ever had, because it used to be that we talked to a cadre of people,
right,
and now we can talk to a billion people.
Juan, I want to go to you, and I know you talked about how, certainly in Malaysia, and perhaps in a lot of countries in Asia, politics is still not so much about ideology, but ethnicity. And at what point does it start to become about ideology? What's the experience in Malaysia?
Well, I think it's a challenging time, because when we talk about what's happening in the West, many of the countries in the West, the debate is about, well, more or less about left and right. So there is an element of ideology that's being contested there. But when it comes to a country like Malaysia, many other parts of Asia, I would suspect, is more tribal, it's more ethnic based, it's more religious based, it's not necessarily ideological based. In fact, in the context of Malaysia, it's not ideology at all. And if you look at the distribution of the members within the political parties, the different political parties in Malaysia, we have quite a few. Not as many as India, perhaps, I don't know. But the reality is you have people from the far left and people from the far right working together in one party just because they come from the same tribe or ethnic group. And this is a difficulty when we're trying to market ideas based on ideologies, based on liberalism, because it doesn't really catch the attention of the voters. They're still thinking about how is it that we can ensure that our ethnic group or our religious group remains as a dominant one in the political structure. So it's a challenging one. I think we haven't reached that stage yet, but of course, the education process needs to continue. But you also raised a very interesting point just now about how these legislators are locked up in a hotel room, how they're forced to vote in certain way. And you talk about the political incentives and so on. And that made me wonder, you know, when you talk about political incentive, maybe there is an incentive to follow what the voters are saying in order to win office. But once they are in office, the incentive is not there anymore. They follow party line. So the education process, I think, really needs to happen on both angles. It needs to happen to the public, to the voters, and it also needs to happen to the politicians themselves. If we target only one structure of society, only the population and not the politicians themselves, I think we're not going to win the political battle. I think both needs to be targeted.
I mean, you know, more and more we seem to be talking about failure of the electoral marketplace. You know, you're alluding to that in Malaysia as well. But yours, you know, I'd actually kind of caution, because at least in the Indian context, there are 1,761 registered political parties. 464 political parties contested the last national elections of 2014. These are all parties that are responding to a certain market. It could well be identity. I'm not disputing that. But clearly there's a market. The fact that there are 7 national parties, 48 state parties, tells you that India's somewhat of an efficient electoral market, I mean, political party marketplace. Because if there is a constituency, there arises a political party to cater to that. Right? So in that context, and Rajesh Jain's favorite phrase, political entrepreneur, having known Rajesh for a long time, Rajesh is now, can the 1,762nd political party to be registered in India be a party for liberal ideas, and can it make a difference?
So actually, if you look at the Indian marketplace...
Can you hear him?
Hello?
No, it's not.
Yeah. Censorship over here. Yeah.
Hello?
At the Liberty Forum, yes. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. Just take this one for now.
Yeah, so if you think about the Indian marketplace, basically, the political parties on the left to right spectrum, at least the ones which have power, are all left of center. I think in 2014, a lot of people thought they were voting for a right of center party, but on the economic side, even that party, BJP, has turned out to be left of center. There's a lot of central planning, there's a lot of statism, there's a lot of socialism, and maybe that's possibly the way they think they can win elections. But I think there's a definite opportunity in India for a right of center, economic right-focused party. The last one that we had was Swatantra Party, which was about 40, 50 years old. Now, to further the liberal ideas, I think there are two approaches, really. You need both things to work in tandem. Changing minds, so you need to persuade people that these ideas make sense, this is the path to prosperity, and you need to channel votes. Yesterday, I think we spent a lot of time on the channeling mind, changing minds, you know, about ideas. But what if we flip the problem, we think about it differently, we say that, look, what does it take in, say, 2019 elections for a classical liberal party to come to power in India? So can you hack politics, building on what some of what Matt said, that you have, by 2019, you will have 500-600 million people with smartphones on 4G networks. You'll have a few hundred million people.
No.
So, in 2019, you'll have a few hundred million people using social media. And living in urban areas, 18 to 39 year olds will be about 50% of the electorate in India, for the millennials. Now, what's very interesting, again, if you look at the political marketplace, all the political parties today, all the 400 odd ones who contest, most of them are trying to, and very few of them actually get enough votes, but they are all, the committed voter base in India is roughly 35% of the 18 plus population in this country. So BJP, Congress, and the leading regional parties collect about, have got a committed base of 35%. And this is pretty much, I think, true in every country of the world. The committed base is only 35 out of 100. The other 65 fall in four categories. There are typically 40, 45% people in many countries who are not voting. There are 10% odd who are not registered to vote. In India, only half the 18 to 24 year olds are registered to vote. Third category is a lot of people voting for the parties who have no hope of winning. The 400 odd parties which contest, independent candidates also who contest, so they have no hope of winning. And there's another about 10 odd percent who are floaters, from switch parties. That's about 65 out of 100. So that is really the blue ocean opportunity, I think, on the liberal side, that what we have to target. We are not going to be able to persuade the hardcore supporters who are there for the existing political parties. But if we can aim, if a new party, liberal party, can aim to get 20 out of the 65 using digital methods, so social, micro-targeting, using Facebook and Twitter, and actually, again, when we look at hacking politics, how can it be done? We really are looking at three things that we are asking voters to do. Number one is, in the Indian context, sort of SMS your voter ID so that we know who you are. Okay, so the voter ID gives us, it's an ID which tells you about the voter, number one. Second is primaries to select candidates in that constituency. Again, today candidates are thrust top down in a constituency by the political leadership, the high commands, as it were, sitting in wherever, the headquarters. But if you have a local contestant, you can now use electronic, you know, computer-based or mobile-based voting for people to select their own candidate. And then, on election day, you need a commitment of 30 minutes that people go out to vote. So it's a low activity that we are asking people to do. We're not asking them to convert their ideas completely, but we are saying, if there's a narrative, if there is some amount of leadership that is there, that look, this is your future. India has had socialism for the last 70 years, and you see the outcome. Every Indian should have been 10 times richer by now. They are not. So what's landed us in this place? There is an alternative narrative, which I think has to be there. You need the ecosystem of think tanks, etc. But I think a political party focused around this can really accelerate the process, not just in India, but I think in pretty much every country. And what we really need to focus on is 20 out of the 65, 20% of people over 18 years of age, if they can come together with a digital outreach that is there, I think we can start thinking about winning elections.
It's clearly Rajesh has the entire blueprint for a new political party. But before that, I want to go to you and ask you to more, like, take a step back and ask a more, somewhat an academic question, and then also ask you a question about Tea Party. First, is there any evidence that liberalism or, you know, liberal politics has a country or a society has to reach a certain, say, let's say, per capita income before these start to resonate with voters? Is it a function of economic prosperity generally, which could mean various other things, education and all of the social indicators? And second, given Rajesh's blueprint for a new political party, I know you said Tea Party is not a party. It's a grassroots movement. What would you say to Rajesh in terms of lessons learned?
You know, as to the first question, I think it's important to understand that I believe that every human being is fundamentally a liberal at heart. They believe in freedom, they believe in community, they believe in opportunity, they believe in the potential of work to define themselves. Classical liberal ideas are sort of built into our DNA. So I don't write off anybody, and I don't think that it's just a question of economic opportunity, but I do think that that's a core question that every voter would have in the US. I think it's certainly true in India as well. And to the earlier point, I don't think this is a left versus right thing anymore. I think that this idea that the hard right where the fascists are and the hard left where the Marxists are, that never made any sense because they're all authoritarians of a different flavor. And at the other end are people that want to be free and live in their communities and thrive based on voluntary association and cooperation. And it used to be that the insiders controlled the process and it was one flavor of authoritarian or another. Everything Rajesh is talking about is getting to those other voters and getting to those core values. And by the way, classical liberalism, in a world where there's thousands of political parties, maybe there should be billions of political parties because we all have different preferences and goals and dreams and knowledge. But classical liberalism is the only model that tolerates all of that diversity because we're going to agree on a couple things. Don't hurt people and don't take their stuff. And other than that, you should be free to live your own life. So we have that opportunity, and I've now forgotten the second question, so.
Tea Party.
So I think politics is a strictly tactical question. And no matter what you do in terms of trying to take over, in my case, trying to take over the Republican Party and then switching to let's rebuild the Libertarian Party, those are all downstream of the things we have to do to build community and to build an understanding of those values. If you build that machine, the tactics become easier. Maybe it's a new party. Maybe it's taking over an existing party. I don't think it matters.
I think the question was more on party versus movement.
Yeah.
You start off saying this should be a political party for liberal ideas, or do you start off saying this is a movement, citizens' movement for liberal ideas?
Yeah. I would do both. I would experiment because in our case, we're doing both. Free the People is a explicitly non-political platform that we're using, and we're talking to disaffected Democrats and progressives. We're talking to disaffected Republicans and conservatives, trying to sell them the values of liberty. But we also did a Gary Johnson super PAC. And we didn't do that because we thought Gary Johnson could win, but we did it because whether we like it or not, politics is that moment where busy people with families and jobs actually pay attention a little bit to the policy conversation. So understand that politics is a platform, it's a stage to talk about our ideas, and if we do that, I think politics can be a virtuous part of this community building exercise.
Okay. You mentioned Super PAC. I do want to come to campaign finance as a barrier to entry for a new liberal party. But before that, now listening to this, do you think in Malaysia the time is right for a new political party or a grassroots movement?
Well, it's interesting listening to what Rajesh said, and I was actually really amazed when you say that you're trying to take over or you tried to take over the Republican Party. But the point here is there's also a system challenge that we need to consider, which is if you follow the Westminster system, you follow the constituency-based Westminster electoral system, what you get is a situation where even if in terms of popular vote you might be the majority across the country, if you're spread out as a minority in the different constituencies, you will never win.
Not just Westminster, ask Hillary Clinton.
So if the system is not a purely popular vote system or proportional representation, that strategy will be a challenging one because you will never win. I think this is not just a case of finding ways to create a political party, but it was also about measuring the strategy to use based on the system that you operate in. In a country like Malaysia, for example, after looking at what happens when a third party comes in and not having any chance of winning because there are two or just one major coalition that controls everything, the conclusion among the opposition parties in Malaysia is simply that they need to build another mega coalition as well.
And this worries me. As a liberal, I'm more comfortable with more choice. You know, I don't know what would happen if we have like this 1,000 plus political parties. It would be so confusing. But you know, that choice is really important. But how do you operate in a situation where if you have choice among the opposition, but the among those who are trying to promote progressive ideas, but the authoritarian one is the majority and they have this mega coalition, how do you defeat them when the other side is simply divided among themselves? It's not an easy task. And in a country like Malaysia, the strategy they use now is to form a coalition, basically to form a monopoly to defeat another monopoly. You know, you apply market principles, you really would like to see the breakup of a monopoly, right? We don't like monopolies. But the political strategy is such that parties, smaller parties are forced to group together, form a cartel, to beat the other cartel. I don't know what else to do in such a situation. It's a very difficult task. And with that, those who are trying to promote liberal ideas need to make compromises. Because they need to work together with those who are not liberals as well. So in a country like Malaysia, in the last general election, you saw this weird coalition of a social democrat with an Islamist party, with a party that's a bit more liberal than the rest. You know, so you hear a situation where a non-Muslim social democrat who's clearly opposed of any form of authoritarianism saying maybe the Sharia law is not that bad because one of the coalition partners is actually an Islamist party. Mm-hmm. So you need to make compromises. You do compromise. And I think at the end, you know, those who try to promote pure liberal ideas would find it really challenging.
You know, it is paradoxical. And I don't know if you know, you guys know this, but we're talking about liberty and political ideas for, you know, liberal, political means for liberal ideas. The separation of the church and the state is very kind of fundamental to the idea of liberty. Do you know in India the Hindu temples are actually run by the state? Today, in 2017.
Well, in Malaysia the mosques are run by the state as well.
So. But we also do have 1700 political parties. Clearly, temples, places of worship being controlled by the state is not a large enough, or angst against that is not large enough for a new political party to take this cause up, or maybe they've tried and failed. But so that's the paradox in some sense, right? With that, Rajesh, we will come to you. I think there are a lot of discussions about barriers. I think we're talking about now, yes, there are liberal ideas that we need to communicate. We want to do it through political means because that's really the only way to get to achieve change. But then there are significant barriers to this. One big barrier is finance. It is, in that sense, it somewhat keeps away new entrants. How do you tackle the issue of finance for a new political parties to advocate liberal ideas? And I want to get the US example also in this context.
See, I think if you think of it that you're going to create a political party and think of it in the traditional way the political parties have been created over the last, say, 70 odd years in India, I don't think it's going to work. I think the way you got to look at it is you're creating a tech startup, okay, masquerading as a political party. Okay, you want a small team, headquarters. You have, effectively in India, you have 543 constituencies. You need 543 distributed teams, which are there, which have their local sort of organizations. I think very much like what Matt talked about in the Tea Party type of thing. I think you could convert the constraints that are there, both in terms of time, in terms of money, to your advantage in thinking about how you're going to create a political party. You are not going to win the game by playing to the rules that are there. Like even in the narrative has to be that we want to focus on rules, not rulers. Okay, what holds India back? It's the constitutional level rules, which are derived from the British era colonial legacy. You know, our constitution is the longest in the world, and I carry the American constitution with me. Indian one, if you've seen, is 500 pages. You cannot get past the preamble because the rest of it is written in a language which you just can't read. This is the American Constitution. Okay. I forgot to bring the Indian one.
You can't. It's too big.
Complete with all the amendments done since 1787 in a language which an 11 or 12-year-old can read. And one example is the First Amendment, which says, Congress shall make no law abridging freedom of speech. Try reading India's First Amendment, which basically says that you can say whatever you want as long as you don't speak against the government in 1,700 words. So I think we got to think very differently in terms of how we are going to tackle the problem. The finance part, again, if you're thinking like tech startup, okay, how would you do it?
So you're saying finance is not an issue?
It cannot be an issue. Okay, because if you think, if you have money, you are going to just go, then you have to raise money. You got to then promise different things to different people. Okay, that's the same. Then once you're in power, you got to recover the money back.
So the difficulty of doing it is different from do we need it in the first place?
I think if you run it like a tech startup, I mean, I've done some basic calculations. I think over the next 2 years to 2019, I think a sort of $10 million budget, which is seed A round for a startup, I think should be good enough.
For a national party?
Yes.
Because you
cannot compete with other guys who are going to raise $1 billion for the next campaign. Now, you've got to make it, see, today use social media, candidate selection that is there, and use technology to do the targeting. We are not going to go after the entire 100. Think about it. Today, political parties in India have no idea who their customers are, who their voters are. They have no database. They have no idea who voted for them in the last election. Every election, campaigning has to start from scratch.
Sure.
Now, if you can use, building a database of voters, targeting them through technology, through things like marketing automation. I'm saying this is crazy ideas, I know. But if you think out of the box, saying that, look, we need to reach 1 out of 5 people, persuade them, win the election before the voting takes place. In a constituency, you need 20 out of 100 people to actually commit. And then it's just a turnout problem. The election day is just counting what you probably already know before an election.
You know, what Rajesh is saying may not be as outrageous as it sounds in the context of some kind of empirical research that I did in the Indian context, which is to analyze the relationship between money spent by a candidate or a party in elections and their winnability. And actually, there is no, statistically significant evidence, relationship between the two to show that. So it may be a sort of a game theory going on where, your opposition is spending that much, so you're kind of almost forced to spend equally. But having said all of that, it is almost a well-accepted narrative that money is one of the biggest factors in electoral democracies across the world, certainly in the U.S. with your super PACs.
Yeah.
So how does it play out there?
So I don't think what Rajesh is saying is crazy at all. I think it's a natural trend, and it's consistent with everything else that technology and social media does. It equalizes access to knowledge, it equalizes access to organization, and it lowers the power of money. Because in a closed system, and you're running TV ads and you control the message from the top down, your competitors don't have an opportunity to get in. In an open system, through Facebook and other social media techniques, someone without any money at all can dominate the message. And the Tea Party was a great example of this. There would be no Tea Party without Facebook. Moms all across the United States were organizing local communities using Facebook. The cost of that was about zero. Takes some time. It takes some time to meet other people. Candidates did the same thing, and I've already talked about Rand Paul. People don't remember that the Republican Party was against Rand Paul in his run for the U.S. Senate. There was Mitch McConnell, the most powerful Republican in Washington, ran an establishment Republican against him. Rand Paul raised money outside the system. He crowdsourced funding using social media. And part of it, of course, was his dad's platform, the money bombs that Ron Paul did.
And Bernie Sanders showed it. It's possible.
There is another Tea Party candidate, Dave Bratt from Virginia, who beat a sitting Republican majority leader, had so much money he couldn't count it all, Dave Brat beat him literally using so little money that he spent less money on his entire campaign than his competitor did on steak dinners. And this was reported in the FEC reports. This is the new trend. I do think you need some resources to run a campaign, but if you're building a community and part of what you're doing is asking this community to participate in a process, maybe it's rallies, maybe it's door knocking, get out the vote, whatever they're doing, that community is willing to pitch in a little bit to help fund those efforts. So I would suggest that instead of thinking that big money sources are the future of politics anywhere, ask your community to give $5. And again, because of technology, you can raise $5 increments and create a really powerful fundraising machine.
Malaysia, a tech political party?
Yeah, but when I heard the idea, I think it's an exciting idea. And you know, I was thinking in my head, maybe we should go back to Malaysia and start one up. Focus in the next 10 years, what's going to happen and so on. The challenge, however, is everybody uses Facebook, everybody uses Twitter, but if the founders of Facebook and Twitter were to run in an election, I'm not sure if they would win. So there's a difference between those who are contesting in the political field using social media as a tool with people who started up the social media venture. So I think that this model is not quite easily understood yet. The potential is definitely there. But in many developing countries, Malaysia included, I think what voters are still looking for, unfortunately, is not the value of new ideas, not the value of freedom, of liberty, and so on. But they're just asking, you know, I vote for you, what do I get tomorrow? So this development politics is still so widespread. I think offering them freedom is not really going to make it. You know, they're still asking, are you going to build a school in my constituency? Are you going to build that bridge that connects this side of the river to the other side of the river? Are you going to help give me, you know, $100 a month as welfare benefit because I can't even buy lunch for my family?
Sure.
So these are real challenges faced by people in developing countries. We don't yet have the luxury of offering them, vote for me, you get freedom. It's not quite there. It's not going to sell that easily.
Yeah, so that's why I was, so in some sense you kind of counter what Matt was saying. Is liberalism a rich man's luxury? And that's somewhat the prevailing notion among societies in Asia. But you know, Matt says no. Every individual is a liberal in that sense, right?
Well, to an extent, I think. If you look at the Economic Freedom of the World annual report done by Fraser Institute in Canada and released everywhere, if you look at the data, there is a correlation between political freedom and economic freedom. But it's a correlation. So basically, the correlation is countries that has more economic freedom also enjoy higher level of political freedom.
It's not causal.
The causality is not determined. I think that needs to be calculated. And even if we can find causality, which direction of causality is it? Is it political freedom that leads to economic freedom, or economic freedom gives political freedom? I think that is not quite easily determined.
So you don't quite buy the tech startup, political party startup idea. At least you don't think it works in the Malaysian context.
Not immediately. I think if we look in the longer term, you know, really we're looking at 20-year horizon maybe, but 5 years not.
So Rajesh, counter that. I mean, you know, someone saying, where do I get my next meal from? And you're going to them and saying, liberty.
So the good thing for us, I think, is that in the last 70 years, we've just had exactly what we are doing now, where it's the planning, it's lack of liberty, and you have the outcomes which are right there. You know, you look at, there's no good quality education available in India. Healthcare is a disaster. Judicial reforms are not there. This is the reality.
So, yours is more revolutionary. Status quo has failed you, so try something else. That's yours.
Yeah, so basically, and every party today is advocating the same status quo. Every political leader, every party is advocating the same status quo. And that's for a very simple reason. The government interventions in the economy politicize the economy. It criminalizes the politics. And that's where you see the kind of candidates whom you get in politics today. So, till now, I think it was A, very difficult to do an outreach to young, urban, middle-class people across the country. I mean, the numbers were also probably not enough. I think today we are in an India which is probably 50 to 55% urban. There's a lot of aspiration in people. The young people, and people can see a good life, you know, through the spread of media and smartphones, etc. You know that there are better alternatives available. So there's an aspiration which is there. And I think the same kind of stuff that the politicians have been promising all along is not going to work. We know the job creation situation in India, just not happening. We need 12 million jobs a year. There's a backlog of probably 100 million jobs over the last 10 to 12 years. Very limited job creation happening. Across the board, where you have, whether it's education, judiciary, the cities. I mean, you look at city life, which is there in India. Now, these are visible things to people. It's just that there is no one who's gone out and said there is an, that there's an alternative way by which cities can be run, by which education can be provided, by which prosperity can be created. Why is India at $1,700 per capita income? We should have all been, I mean, Indians should have all been 10 times wealthier by now. So these are questions which no political party asks, because all of them are in there in the same sort of bucket. And I think that is the incredible opportunity which is there. Technology, when I say tech startup, it's a way to fast track this process. You have elections in 2 years coming up. Okay, there's a lot of uncertainty that is there. Okay, the government schemes or the plans in India are pretty well known. Okay, there's a lot of angst. And I think Barun said it very well a couple of days ago, that there are a million mutinies going across the country. Can you tap into that? Can you create a second freedom movement, as Amit Verma is going to talk about later tonight? So I think there's a lot of opportunities which are there. Tech becomes a mechanism to leverage this. And I think you've got to sort of seize the moment that's there.
Sure, and I think a lot of that played out in the US election, which is, you know, a lot of the issues that Rajesh raises about jobs and unemployment and all of that, the winner actually said, no, the solution to that is to arm twist businesses into staying back. Does that mean the liberals could not come up with a concrete solution to this problem that would actually answer people's concerns?
I mean, I wouldn't presume to know how this works in other countries, but part of what Donald Trump did was tap into a keen understanding that the game was rigged, that the system was padding the pockets of insiders and crony capitalists and politicians. And yesterday, everything that Barun said, all the people that pitched the Shark Tank, it was half populism. It was half rage against the machine. It was half, this system is corrupt and you will never get ahead. You will never be able to make a decent living for your family as long as the insiders control the process, combined with there's a better way. There is an opportunity where you could make more money for your family, where you could start your own business, where you could do things that have never been done in this country before, as long as we could get the political process out of the way. So I don't think we should be making calm academic arguments about classical liberalism. I think we should be libertarian populists. I think we should own the fact that the system is broken and tap into that unmet marketplace that Rajesh is talking about.
But what's the, I mean, so yes, there is angst, but you also have to propose a solution.
And, yeah.
And Donald Trump said, I'll make sure these businesses stay back here and hire you guys. I mean, Thomas made it very simple. How do you get a simplistic version of a liberal solution to this problem?
Well, you know, there's very different interpretations on how Donald Trump won. And my joke is that once everybody in the United States realized that the system was rigged, that all politicians are liars, they chose a professional, someone that really knows how to lie. So I don't know. I mean, I think a lot of people, and I talked to a lot of Tea Partiers that voted for Donald Trump, I think a lot of them voted for him not because they believed a single word that he said. They didn't believe any of his promises, but they knew the system was so broken that they wanted to send in a wrecking ball to take it down and start over. So, you know, he definitely tapped into that economic populism. and the anxiety about opportunity. There's a lot of Americans, particularly young people, that don't think they'll do better than their parents.
Right.
And he tapped into that. But I think that's a global thing right now. Government is the boot on the throat of opportunity, and right. We need to tap into that.
I want to open it up for questions, and I will hope to have as many questions as possible. I don't know if mics go around, or how does it work? Do we have mics, or should they just stand up, try, and shout? Okay, please.
Go ahead.
Shout, no problem.
That we have, that we really need to raise huge amounts in order to win, which is where Rajesh's 10 million fits in. So that seems to be a reasonable model, right? Or the alternate that I was thinking was, because you also mentioned Tea Party, that the ground for that was created over the last 4 years when the Tea Party was mobilizing as a movement. They didn't have Donald Trump. Donald Trump was actually nowhere in the Tea Party movement on the street. But the angst that it mobilized, he tapped in as a super salesman. That means it worked both ways, that once you lowered your capital, yet you were able to tap in to something that had already been built up. So that means these two factors need to go together. What do you think? Because unless we are able to get both right, we may not be able to make the kind of breakthroughs that the technology today allows.
Okay. Matt?
Well, I think both of those observations are absolutely true, and it was particularly true even before Donald Trump took on Hillary Clinton, that he was raising just a fraction of what other candidates were raising. Jeb Bush had so much money he couldn't count it all, and Donald Trump just crushed him. And that shows that money is not the only factor. And he did tap into that economic anxiety. Most people don't remember that Donald Trump really won just because of a couple of states. And there are Rust Belt states like Michigan, where opportunity was viewed as lost. And he beat Hillary Clinton in traditionally Democratic states just at the margin. And that's why he won, despite the fact that he lost the popular vote. And this is sort of the upside and the downside of everything that I think we're talking about up here. On the one hand, technology and the democratization of politics is this huge vehicle to get our ideas out there. On the other hand, some populist demagogue might hijack that process. So we better not be afraid of this. I think we jump in with both feet and realize that this is the new normal. And whether we like it or not, this is how ideas and politics will be defined, and we should own that process.
Ajish, if you have anything to add quickly.
Yeah, just quickly, I think, Varun, I think the point which has to be made out to people, and I think that's the sense is already there, that the government is not your friend, it's your enemy. Okay, what we have in India is PPP, perpetually planned poverty. And that sort of narrative is now coming back to the fore. It's been there since the 70s, it keeps coming back. So I think, again, if you think differently, this narrative that can we persuade 1 in 5 people, whether it's the ones who feel the angst or whether it's the ones who are non-consumers of today's politics, okay, that the government is basically your enemy, what you need is an alternate method to create prosperity for yourself and your family. I think that's what you need to do that. And I think this message has never been communicated in India in the last 40 to 50 years.
Lewis?
Okay. The attractiveness of people like Trump is that the system is broken, therefore try something new. And that's the scary part, because the alternatives seem to be also scary when people will realize that 3 years later. It happened with the Aam Aadmi Party, etc. in India. You see, with Trump. And therefore, is there a fear that this Nirvana fallacy is playing out and people are going to be more worried about looking at alternatives which are untested and then go back to the old tested problems?
I think the question is, stoking angst is great, but it could have perverse consequences if somebody else emerges victor, as perhaps what most people feel happened in the US.
And I said half rage against the machine and half positive opportunity-based messaging. Budget schools here are a great example of that. The machine has failed children, but through voluntary cooperation and family solving problems, we've figured out a better way to educate children in this country. So it's not just the system sucks and we need to burn it down. It's like we can work together to solve problems as long as the government would keep out of our way.
Yeah, Rajesh?
I think the
important question that Louis raises is, do you worry if you stoke angst, it could actually end up, we could end up with worse outcomes than before?
See, I think what has to be communicated to people is that every political party is basically identical. So you play this point about populism, which was made yesterday, us versus them. Okay, that point has to be reinforced, that every political party today is essentially with the same sort of narrative, with the same expansion of government. I think someone put it very well, the purpose of government is to expand government, yesterday night, evening, one of the sessions. This narrative of what government really is doing, and it's visible everywhere around, but no one has pointed this out. I mean, I started doing this with my kid a few years ago, and we go out, we take him on a bus ride, and I would tell him, just look around you and look at all the things that government is doing. You know, you see and then ask yourself the question, should government do that? Can that be done by a private player? You see these banks. I mean, Indian banks basically are in the hole of $200 billion, the government-owned banks. 70% of the banks are owned by the government. Now, who's going to pay for all of that? You look at, again, like the education system. You look at many other sectors. No one's pointing these things out, that there is a common thread which runs it. Everyone, every Indian pays taxes. The core narrative which is there is only 3% Indians are paying taxes. But every person today, when you buy, the poorest person is basically because you pay high indirect taxes. Every person pays taxes. Now, once you start making people aware, because this kind of stuff has not been told to people, because every political party basically benefits from the current system. They all want to expand government. And we've seen that in the last 3 years also. Okay, we are seeing, I think, probably the largest expansion of government in recent times under what theoretically should have been a right-of-center economic party that a lot of people thought they were voting for. There's no sign of minimum government. There's no sign of structural reforms in key areas. Now, once you start thinking like that, there has to be a carrier for these messages. This narrative has to go out to people. And I think that's where you're going to start seeing the shifting happening. If you are not going to point out people to something, just observe where government is like air. It's all around you in India. That's the message which we have to take to people.
I hope you're taking your son to a temple also to tell him how his faith donation is actually an attack to the government.
Discrimination.
Yeah, go ahead. I think he has the mic. Please go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. You. Thank you. Ruben Diekhoff, Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom. Because we're talking about a winning political strategy. I mean, we are talking a lot about winning minds and hearts, but I think the liberal message is in way too many cases only appealing to the minds. It's not appealing to the hearts. Look at Bernie Sanders. I don't agree at all with his policies, but look at how he mobilized especially the millennials. And the millennials, when you look at them, what they really care about, the top two issues is one, opportunity, which is a pretty liberal message, but also equality. And they don't necessarily see the state and or the government as the enemy. It's not so much for them about big government versus small government. It's about the efficiency of the government. I just wanted to raise, because I'm not 100% sure that if we still always showcase the government and the state as the enemy, I'm not really sure that you can really win, especially the hearts of the millennials.
Okay, are we being too rational and logical?
Okay.
Are we, that's really the question.
There was a student yesterday that brought up the issue of social justice. And I think when we talk about the rule of law, I think young people hear something very different than what we mean. But I think we should embrace the cause of justice and the idea that the law should treat everybody just like everybody else. There shouldn't be any special favors. Tap into that sense of right and wrong and add that to the opportunity message. I think that is what young people are looking for. They believe, they want to believe in a world where there is justice.
I think if they've taken over the word liberal, we should take over the word justice.
Yes.
I think it's about fairness. I think even a kid understands, you know, fairness and unfairness when discrimination happens. And I think what governments basically are doing is they don't care about the electorate. They care about the selectorate. They are caring about those 20-25% people of different castes, coalition groups that they are collecting together.
But Rajesh, this question is, how do you appeal to the heart? I mean, in some sense, like, how do you... He says these are all in the mind. Government,
yeah, see,
and non-government and...
See, I think the way this has to work is, first, we are not targeting all 100 people. Okay? There is today in India, there is a large percentage, of course, because of this poverty machine that has been created over the last 70 years, there's a large number of poor. Okay, now, do the poor want to stay in the villages? Okay, do they want to be doing agriculture jobs? Okay, that is what the people in power want them to do. And that is the way you see the benefits playing
so
out.
So you're saying there's not that much of a distinction between the heart and the mind, essentially.
Yeah, the middle class which is there, even the poor today, I think the aspirational value is that you want to be rich in life.
Okay.
I mean, which party have you talked, have you seen, Praveen, in India?
Sure.
Talk about creating prosperity. It's all about poor.
Yeah.
Every party basically runs a poverty machine, the pro-poor programs. And it's not just true in India. It's probably true in many other countries because that's where the money is. That's where you can expand government.
Sure.
And the alternative narrative has to be brought about. And I think this message will resonate with people.
Okay. Okay.
I'm not fully comfortable with this idea that the government is the enemy, because the notion that we're trying to make here is we want to be part of the government. You know, if we say that the government as an entity is the enemy, then why do we want to go in there? It doesn't match these two things.
And, it's an important question. I think Rajesh has thought about that. Yeah.
I think the key is this goes back to James Buchanan's work and Taleb's work on public choice theory. I think the message we have to take out is that there are constitutional level rules and there are the in-period politics which are there. What we are talking about is rules, not rulers. We want the constitutional rules to do what Barun said yesterday, restrain those in power. We actually want to reduce the powers of government. Now, unfortunately, we can try doing that through persuasion of the people in power. It's not going to work. You can try creating a pressure group from the outside. I don't think it's going to work.
But that's what one's saying. You can't possibly go and argue, put me in government so that I can reduce myself.
No, so here's what you do. You put out... For this, a political party should actually put out, here's the first 100-day plan, the first one-year plan. These are the bills we will pass. This is how government power goes down. Okay, this is how you will benefit from this. In a way, this is exactly what Trump is doing in the US. He said something in the campaign, in his first executive orders, he's doing exactly that. No one expects political parties to do what they say.
Okay.
So do the opposite of that.
Okay. Yeah. Any of you got the mic? Yeah.
I just want to share our experience in iPolicy. I'm from Center for Civil Society. We organize iPolicy programs for school, for college students. And when we talk about education, you know, when we tell them that government schools are not good, we show them the data on learning outcomes, and they never come to conclusion, or they never like the conclusion that they should be shut down. At best, when we say, even if we talk about the cost efficiency, you know, efficiency, the learning outcome versus cost, even then, they don't favor shutting down of government schools. When we when we propose to them that you know, that poor should have the choice, so what about direct cash transfer in the account of poor and let them make a choice whether they want to go either vouchers or DCTs, whether they want to go to private schools or government schools, they like that. Vis-a-vis, if we say that then they will be able to go to private schools, that they don't like. So they don't favor shutting down or anti-government rhetoric as much as the rhetoric of choice.
Sure, in some sense that's what the core liberalism is. It's about choice, isn't it?
Yeah. I think that's right, and it gets to the question of individual control over your own life. I don't think particularly young people in our country, you were describing this, they don't hate the government, and they're agnostic about how to get these things done, but when it comes to choice and opportunity and justice for all, I think those are the sort of emotional messages that go to our core strengths as the rule of law. That's what it's all about.
Yeah. See, just to add one point, I think, there is this mythical thing, I think, goes back to what probably Bastiat wrote 150 odd years ago. I think most people have this romantic view of government, that there is this great thing which has this money-making machine. So every budget they can allow, say $5 billion here, $4 billion here, there's this factory producing money which can then be distributed to people. I think the message which has to go out to people is that you are paying for this. This is how much you are paying for it. If banks, basically public sector banks, every Indian, rich or poor, is going to be paying $1,500 to $2,000 for bailing out the private banks in the next few years, then do you want those banks to be in business? I think you've got to take this view that governments by itself are not money creators. That message, again, see, these are messages which have not been told to us. You know, in our textbooks which you read, governments have to do this, 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 this. There is no reference to how is that financed? Who's paying for that? Once you put this across, I mean, incentives work. You talk to kids in this language, okay, that if you want something like this, you are going to have to pay for some for this much amount of money. Then now do you want this or not?
Rajesh, can I just jump in there? I think that what you're talking about is what needs to be done by us. We need to tell people that they are paying for all this. But when it comes to winning political strategy, I don't think that is a winning political strategy, because these people, regardless of how many times you tell them that the government is taking your taxpayers' money in order to bail out a failed company, they are going to say, yes, government, please take money from the likes of you and you so that I can get my lunch tomorrow. That is a challenge that we're not answering yet. And I think this comes back to Ruben's question just now, where we're not winning the arguments, we're not winning the hearts of people with this argument. It's too intellectual, it's too highbrow, too up there, too investment banking type of thing. I'm comfortable dealing with that. I'm comfortable talking about it. I can talk about political financing, rules, regulations,
and so on.
In five-star hotels.
How do you get
that?
Yeah.
If I were to go out there talking about this to the common people out there, it is not a winning political strategy.
So I know we could go on. I will have to go and take other questions. See, I've seen three hands. I think he's got the mic, and then I'll finish that table. Yeah.
Just one
second. Maybe we'll take two questions together, you and you. Yeah.
This is for Rajesh. Gives us a new hope about new liberal political party. But looking at the available liberal parties in India, I think one of the major debate is about the role of the state. How much and what? And I think that has to be resolved. And of course, there are issues about liberal political parties and why we can't come together is a very near problem. Thank you.
Okay, so the question is, role of the state, how will liberal parties define that? Yeah, please go ahead.
I am Babu Joseph from Kerala. I don't know how many of us who are sitting here in this hall have stood as a candidate in an election, or how many of us have effectively campaigned in an election?
Okay, how many?
I'm not asking that question. Yeah, I'm just putting that question. As a member of the Swatantra Party, I didn't contest the elections, but I had a candidate put up by our group in my own constituency.
Okay,
and I was leading the campaign. I was leading the campaign. Out of that election, what I have learned was we have to have charismatic leaders. We need not necessarily sell the idea of limited government, decentralization, or free market and all that. We have to have, if we want to propagate that ideology, we have to have convinced liberals, but we have to have credible leadership.
Okay.
That is one.
Okay.
Number one. Yeah.
Please.
Number two,
yeah.
See, let me finish. I am the one who has experienced that. That's what I am telling you. Have the patience. Number one. The context or the backdrop in which you are contesting the elections. Like Trump, he had the right context and he has a charism. Whether you agree with it or not, he had the charism. Number three, we need the critical mass of people to support you. However effective a speaker you be, if on the date of elections, if you don't have booth committees who can transfer your supporters into votes, it can be a failure. So credible leadership,
sure.
Context, and a critical mass of people to support you. These are vital to,
sure.
to contest
okay.
any elections.
So two questions I'm going Thank to combine, you. Rajesh. One is essentially about manifesto in the sense, what is the role of a state? Are we going to communicate that for a liberal party? The second is a face. This perennial question about, do you need a face or can it just be a collective movement?
Yeah. So I think on the role of state state question, again, I think, and I link it back to the point earlier about the hearts and minds. I think, and what Matt said earlier, I think the liberal ideas are basically the ones which touch people every day. It's just that we've not made it obvious to them. Everyone's doing voluntary exchanges, which are making them better off. They are interacting in the market every day. Okay. Now, the dependency on the state, the government actually wants to make you more dependent. Okay, and that is the point we have to make, that all that does is really engender poverty. No one is making this point. That the point I'm trying to make is that this narrative, and we've got to sharpen it. It's not that I've thought it out completely, but you have to sharpen this. In India, in the last 50 years, which parties have you seen, other than Swatantra, which sort of died off in the early 70s, which parties have made this alternative pitch, alternative narrative? No one. And once you start sensitizing people to where you can see government all around, okay, you will start seeing a different perspective. That is there, number one.
Face.
Second is on the face. Yes, I think there are two models which are there. I think the Tea Party was a sort of, there's a spider model, as Matt told me a few months ago, spider, which has a face. Okay, there's one core, one leader and so on. And there's a starfish model. I think what you need to do is, a lot of the movements that you're seeing in India in the last year or so, okay, are mostly faceless movements. There's mobilization that is happening, and I think the new faces will emerge. Okay, you have to give it some time. I think the new faces, the new voices are going to emerge. I refuse to believe that, you know, it's just a few of us here who've got ownership on the liberal ideas. I think a lot of people who feel like this, but it's a coordination problem. I think if you have a signaling mechanism where, look, if you can stand up and then talk to people about these ideas, I think you will have these emerging in every community in the country.
You agree with that, Matt? Don't go searching for a charismatic leader, they'll emerge.
Yes, I agree with your three components, but I would flip them and start with community and then find context, and it's kind of a build it and they will come kind of model. If you build a community based on the right set of values, leadership will emerge from the bottom up, and I think that's how you prevent a Trump populists from hijacking your movement. You got to get the values right. You got to get the constituency right. And the problem with putting all your eggs in the political leadership basket is that politicians can let you down once in a while. I don't want to shock people, but it happens.
I think you had a question. Yeah, the mic there, please.
So this is just tying in something that Ruben had mentioned about. I mean, you know, winning the hearts. I think one thing that I found missing in this amazing discussion has been that it's not just the state and the individual, there's also a community. And a lot that the state comes in and starts to do is to, in a sense, at least in India, and perhaps in many other developing countries, to protect the individual from the community. So perhaps, and that's something for I think all of us to mull about, that one of the major weaknesses of the state actually has been in the protection function of what we were talking about yesterday on life and liberty. So perhaps what we need to focus on in a political movement is the protection function of the state to protect you, and therefore you can, you know, perhaps the fear of the community can become lesser.
It's a very good point.
Yep. No? Okay, so it's a comment that's
yeah,
well taken. I see a hand right at the back, yeah.
Hi, good morning. My name is Kiran. I have a question. Primarily, why are we looking at the youth just as a vote bank and not as future politicians themselves? What about grooming long-term characters who would be willing to take up this ownership or this onus and having an enabling mechanism where you basically strengthen civil society, which is fragmented today, and have them working on the community, the freebies that the community looks for, is being provided by the community that is backing these politicians who are going to get into the state maybe 2 terms, 3 terms from now, but something long-term that way, as just opposed to them as a vote bank.
Sure, I think Matt spoke about that, which is grooming leaders. Do you have thoughts on that? I mean, why,
Yeah, I think part of, we always had, as classical liberals in our country, we had this sort of immaculate conception view of political leadership. We wanted to elect John Galt. We wanted him to go to Washington, where he would inevitably get torn apart by the political establishment, and then we blame John Galt for failing. And I think if you want better political leaders, you better create a viable constituency, a machine that actually supports them when they do the right thing. That makes it easier to win re-election because you've done the right thing. If you're sending people to commit political suicide, it is the perfect failed strategy that only reinforces the bad guys and the incentives that, that they exploit to grow government.
I think that's a really crucial point. You know, as we aim to win or support people to win political power, you need to create the constituency to support them as well. And this is where the role of think tanks and the role of us as civil society organizations come in. I think it's really crucial that we support the building of that constituency that would support liberal ideas and not just focus on the political powers. The two must happen together. I'm not saying prioritize one over the other. I'm saying both must happen together.
But I thought you said we do too much thinking and not.
Well, this is the thing. At the moment, we're talking among ourselves, and many of the challenges are not really addressed by engaging with people who will be voting in the future. One of the challenges that I find in Malaysia, for example, is the ideas that we talk about are way too complex. We were chatting just now before we came on stage about how we need to simplify almost all the messages to 140 characters. You know, Trump somehow managed to do that. How do you stop crime? Build a wall. You know, and we don't have that simplified answers yet, and I think we need to do that.
I think the point very well made, simplified. Any questions?
Just one point to add.
Okay.
I think the point about youth, not just as a vote bank, but also as political leaders, I think what you see in Indian politics today is basically the only sort of youth who get through the system are the one with parental linkages, you know, because of the top-down system that is there. I think what you need in India are primaries, which will really allow communities to get created and grassroots leaders to emerge, and that will, I think, create a new new energy in the political space.
Fully well, Donald Trump emerged through a primary. Go ahead.
I'm a little skeptical about this. My name is Sanjay George. I'm also from Kerala. And anyway, the point is, Bastiat once said that government is the great fiction by which everyone attempts to live at the expense of everyone else. And there is this, there is a wealth creator and a parasite in every human being. And we are delegating even the task of trying to live as a parasite of other people to political parties when we outsource this function to them. And how much of human nature are we, you know, people respond to incentives. And unless you educate people that a free market can do a better job than trying to manipulate a select elite in a center of power to control your fellow human beings, I'm not very optimistic about a political process bringing about change. I'm not very optimistic about political processes being changed. I would prefer the market and an attempt to reduce the size of government in the long run.
I think he's talking about the inevitable political coalition that is the parasite class, and how do we break that up? Is that
yes?
Yes.
My point is, we would have endless debates about how to create a strategy for winning, but we will just create new monsters to replace the old ones.
Well, let's talk practically about this, because in this room you have politicians, you have political organizations, you have think tanks. You have academics, you have grassroots organizers, and we were talking about this before, that just 10 years ago, all of these institutional structures were siloed, and we weren't talking to each other. And I think today the opportunity is that our audience for ideas is so big that all of us need to rethink those silos. We need to break down those walls, and we need to start talking to people that we didn't think we could talk to before. Because most people, I don't believe, are parasites. I think most people want to live in a world where they have opportunity and they're generally left alone in that order. But it doesn't work unless you have good ideas. It doesn't work unless you educate. It doesn't work unless you translate those ideas into simple language and then organize people. All of these things are all of our jobs now. We don't get to pick and choose just one of them. We can't just write a better book. We got to translate it into a 140 character tweet.
I think the way I interpreted this question is maybe we shouldn't focus on winning political strategy because it runs the risk of polluting the purity of the values and principles of liberal ideas.
Yeah, see, I think...
And I think Juan referred to that when he said the coalitions get together and lose their ideology.
See, I think we can... There are two paths, you know. We can keep trying to create... We need, of course, to create more think tanks and ideas and all of these things. Every year that we lose out on, 25 million people in India don't get educated properly. Now, there are... the government, I think the phrase was used as a democide. You know, the number of people who are basically forced to a life worse than death because of government policies is just growing. I think the message which has to go out is that individual freedom plus government control is basically a constant. So if one goes up, the other one comes down. And what is really required, and that's where the constitutional level rules point comes in, it's that you need, in Hindi there is this word called lagam. You know, you need in English, it's the on the horse, the bridle that is there. Government is basically a wild horse, okay? You need it, but you need to tame it. And that is where you need to have constitutional controls. It's not about just an individual who will perhaps do the right thing. For whatever is there in the US, this constitution that I showed earlier actually has reasonable level of constraints that are there. And that's what's required in India, because in India what happened was in 1947 when we wrote the constitution, we basically picked up most of the constitution from the 1935 Government of India Act, which was for a colonial rule, colonial power. 242 out of 395 articles picked up verbatim from there. So the skin color of the rulers changed. Nothing else did. Lutyens, Delhi, Rashtrapati, the Indian Police Act of 1860, okay, sedition, okay, Indian Telegraph Act 1885, the Bombay Municipal Corporation Act 1888, they're all still there. The bureaucracy, etc., all of these things. Now, that is the colonial rule that is there. People in India, we got independence in August, on 15th, 1947. We did not become a free country. And I think you've got to listen to Amit. I'm probably taking away his thunder today evening. India needs a second freedom movement. There are no two ways about it. That is really the only path that we are going to... That you've got to push that out to people that this government is basically British Raj 2.0.
Okay. And so I'm going to end with Juan's comments on winning a political strategy. Does that mean dilution of certain values of liberalism?
Well, if we're looking into winning political powers, one way or another, you will need to make some compromises. You know, you cannot avoid this. And maybe to respond to Sanjay's point just now as well, the irony here is, in order to reduce the size of government, you need to be in government first. There's no way to reduce the size of government if you're outside of the government. You need to be in. But in order to win, you need to make some compromises, and most importantly, the message that we sell must be something that touches people's heart. This marketing strategy that we have really needs to be refined further, otherwise we will never get there.
Okay, so don't be too intellectual, think with your heart is the final message, and we're going to end with that. Thank you all of you, and thank you.